This challenge has very simple rules. The only rule is that for every boss, I must use a different weapon class. Coincidentally, if you use two weapon classes for bosses like Nameless King, where the phases are their own separate bosses, the weapon classes should work out perfectly with the number of bosses in the game. To determine which weapon class I use, I will use a random number generator website to spin a wheel after each boss. The reason I spin immediately after each boss is so there is no way for me to plan at all until I actually get my hands on a weapon. This keeps it interesting and adds more of a challenge. If I can't access a weapon class due to game progression, I'll spin again until I get one that I can access. That didn't happen more than maybe once or twice in the playthrough. The first area is the only place where lack of weapon classes is a problem. Also, once I beat a boss, I am locked out of the weapon class I used for the rest of the playthrough and must unequip my weapon. If the wheel lands on a weapon class that I don't have, I have to go through the levels with bare fists until I find a suitable weapon. I also can only use one weapon class at a time. So for example, I can't use any shields for stamina regeneration or parrying if I didn't roll shields, and I can't use a chime for buffing if I've already used it. There aren't any rules beyond that, so let's roll to see what we get. You may have already noticed that I chose a pyromancer, and that's because the wheel landed on axes, so that determined my starting class. I had a separate, smaller wheel for starter weapon classes, so I wouldn't be stuck spinning it a million times, but after this, I'll use the real wheel. As usual, nothing special in the tutorial area. Nothing but me making my way to Gundyr and almost dying to him on three occasions. At least when that's done, we can help ourselves to 5 levels, all of which will go towards strength and dex due to the nature of the run. And next? Well, it's time to spin the wheel. Now you can see just how many weapon classes are on this wheel. Everything but torches, which I completely forgot about. It tried to give me great bows. Funnily enough, this wasn't the first time this happened. Before recording this spin, it actually tried to give me great bows. The game really wanted me to use a great bow for some reason. It took a couple spins, but eventually, I finally got a reasonable roll that can be found even in the high wall, a simple spear. Now, you can farm for this from a few of the enemies, but I opted to do this the easy way. I did the standard death run to the Estus Shard Room for the key, then freed Grey Rat. His wares are quite valuable to us in this run. In some cases, he's our only supplier for a weapon class. Such as in this case, where he offers a humble spear at a cheap price. In any case, we have a weapon now, so there's no excuse to not push forward and open up the rest of the map where those other sweet weapons are hiding. It's just Vort. He's not much of a guard dog at all. Why do I always do this? Alright, this is the one. I can feel it. There we go. Do that spray attack, and leave your booty open for the poking. Another spray attack, another poke. I like stabbing Vort's booty with a spear as much as the next guy, but I'm ready for a change of pace. Conveniently, the wheel landed on pyromancy flames, and considering our circumstances, we're pretty well off in that regard. But before going any further into the next area, I'm just gonna casually throw myself off a cliff 15 times, because who can say no to some free levels? Our basic fireball is much better than you'd think, not to mention very FP efficient. The undead settlement is a pyromancer's dream, with explosive barrels to catch groups of enemies. A local pyromancer just waiting to be freed to teach you what he knows. And a fire clutch ring for a modest boost to fire damage. This playthrough has been off to a rocky start as far as boss fights are concerned, so I was hoping to smooth it out some by burning the greatwood with some pyromancy. Needless to say, things didn't go according to plan, and I got bullied by a tree. This fight was a free aiming nightmare for my dinky fireballs. I even tried great combustion to see if it would be easier to land hits. It was easier, sometimes, but the extra FP cost meant that I was mostly just wasting all my FP with my poor free aiming skills. By the end of the fight, I ran out of Ash and Estus and had to punch my way to victory, which was, ironically, easier than trying to hit it with fireballs. After getting through all that, I keep my stats well-rounded for the challenges ahead. You know the drill. Time to spin. And the next weapon class is... Ultra Greatswords! I ran into a problem here because I sent Greywide out to pillage too early, so I had to beat another boss for him to come back and sell this Vihunder. While I didn't have the easiest option anymore, I still had another option that didn't require me to fight any more bosses. All I had to do was run all the way down to Farron Keep for the Greatsword, which, contrary to what its name implies, is an Ultra Greatsword. It'll take a bit more investment into strength to use it, but that's nothing we can't achieve as we collect soul items between our task of snuffing out flames. There are also some enemies that potentially drop many souls, assuming we can get a single hit on them. Look at this spammer, how pathetic. Let's see you in a 1v1 fight, melee only, oh. So that was a fun time. Logically, after getting absolutely destroyed by everything that breathes in this swamp, I thought it was time to challenge the area boss. Seeing as I first tried this with ease last time, I had to prove to myself that that was not a fluke. Well, I got the answer to that quickly. That dream died, and when it died, it really died. This fight took way too many attempts than it should have with the greatsword. I also refused to upgrade it because I saw how fast these guys can get steamrolled with a greatsword, so I wanted it to be a fair fight. It was indeed a fair fight. I got my wish there. For some reason, I had trouble getting backstabs this time around, and for a second there, I thought I'd make up for it with a backstab for the win, but no, I had to look dumb and frantically swing my sword to make sure he's dead. This playthrough has been, interesting for sure. So let's make sure we have more endurance this time around before spinning for the next weapon. So our next weapon class is... hammers! I can live with that. I even have a good one already hanging out in my inventory, the Reinforced Club. Now I get to say my favorite line again. I reinforced my reinforced club and went to tie up some loose ends around the world. When I was finished with those errands, I challenged the next boss to what should have been a relaxing, one-sided fight. This playthrough has not been kind to my ego so far. A good thing about the Reinforced Club is that it has some bleed buildup, which worked well against the Crystal Sage in particular. Are you guys all gonna occupy that same corner, or what? Alright, wish me luck. I'm going in. With both roadblocks out of the way, our path is slightly less linear now, and we have a couple of choices for the next area to take on. Rolling shields solidified the next boss as the Deacons, because I fought Wolnir with a shield last time, so naturally, I wanted to change it up for this video. The Stone Parma functioned well for bashing my way into the Cathedral, but I wanted something a little more interesting. Since we're going to be spinning a lot of wheels in this run, I had a specific shield in mind. After making it to the Cleansing Chapel bonfire, I headed down into the catacombs, where I started taking out the bone wheels to hopefully get their shield. As I cleared out this area, I mostly had a fun time of using the traps to my advantage, because the swordsmen could quickly overwhelm me and my shield. Fast forward to about an hour later, and I finally could claim my bone wheel shield. Farming for that long gave me enough souls to get the strength to use it, and after that, I was off to the Cathedral once again. This is the kind of weapon that looks like it would have bleed buildup, but doesn't. Regardless, the AR is nothing to sneeze at, and the weapon art works wonders against the strongest enemies in the Cathedral. Except for Patches. This guy had too much Estus for me to deal with, so I tried doing things the dirty way, but Patches, being the clever little trickster he is, actively used my own traps against me. It was more trouble than it was worth, but I did finally bait out a roll on the shortcut bridge where he plunged to his death. Not so fun being on the other end of the cliff, is it, Patches? I've had enough trouble for now, so I decided to get the Deacons over with. I was fully prepared for a fun game of spinning and winning with my fancy bone wheel shield. It's not like my damage was bad, but I was getting deja vu from the Royal Rat Vanguard, with each hit being countered by 5 deacons ganging up on me before I can recover. This led to a very unfavorable situation where I ran out of Estus. On the Deacons of the Deep. And I may have been ready to dodge the curse, but I wasn't ready for the candlestick. I can't even shield myself behind an excuse for this one. Just add that one to the list, I guess. I'm completely numb to all shame by now. If it provides any solace at all, I do get a decent amount of levels from that fight. Moving on to the next weapon class, we have pikes. Unfortunately, my only choice was to commit to a farming session that dragged on for several hours to get the pike from the enemies outside the halfway fortress bonfire. I can't stress enough how relieved I was to finally see something drop, and it almost felt like a waste of effort considering the boss I planned to use it against. I did something that I've never done before, and fought Wolnir first after speaking with Henri, so we'll see if this fails the quest or not. For Wolnir, the pike didn't have any problems reaching his bracelets, and I got very lucky this time around and finished him off before he had time to do any of the sword and summoning shenanigans. So without further ado, let's spin again. Our next weapon class is staves. As you'll see in a moment, this couldn't have worked out better. First, we'll need to meet with Rosaria to respec accordingly, then use a cheat code called Alt-F4 for infinite respecs. To make our magic worthwhile, we need to pick up the pieces of the build that are scattered around the world. If we buy enough spells from Orbeck, he'll give us the Young Dragon Ring for an extra boost to our spell damage on top of the boost we get from the Crown of Dusk. Lastly, I buy the Saint's Ring to attune an extra spell and upgrade the Heretic's staff to +5 before heading back out. All the preparation I did for my spells did not disappoint. Many enemies in this area are easier with ranged tactics and are considerably weak to magic. Horus himself was no problem at all, owing to the fact that he is far less dodge happy than most NPCs. With that portion of Henri's quest done, I took the super secret entrance into the demon ruins and continued using rats to test out my spells before moving on to bigger targets. Look how ridiculous this is. You don't even have to aggro the worm to do this. Pestilent Mist worked so well against the sandworm that I was very eager to test it on the old Demon King. The only problem with that is he trapped me in my own mist and almost killed me with it, and I gotta say, the blue Tearstone Ring proved itself once again as the underdog. I didn't need the mist by any means, plus his attacks get a little too close to one-shotting me. There's no need to senselessly put myself at risk by staying close, so I did what any good mage would do and kept my distance, firing away until his lights went out. After that, I reverted my stats back to a melee build and got my vigor to 20. This time, the wheel chose greatswords. And I picked up a pretty cool one earlier, that one being the Executioner's Greatsword. I had the resources to get it to +5 before going to Irithyll. Like the staff in the Smouldering Lake, the greatsword is built for destroying the enemies in Irithyll. Most enemies here have very low poise and can be stunlocked to death. Except for Doris here, but she didn't do much to fight back anyway. We're gonna not make our way to the shortcut. Then prove to Pontiff Sullivan that your greatsword doesn't need to have all those fancy glowing elements to win. So while I was keeping things simple, this guy was blinding me with all his flashy special effects. Practically every attempt of this fight was very sloppy, including the final one. I got backed into a corner, literally, and started spamming R1 and praying that it worked. At this point, my goal is to get Vigor to 30. I consider that a good milestone for people that get hit a lot. Now, it's time to spin the wheel again. Our next weapon class will be daggers. This gave me an idea. First, I bought the bandit's knife from Grey Rat, then upgraded it as much as I could. On top of the innate bleed of the weapon, I could finally use some of the Carthus Rouge I picked up in the catacombs for an early-ish dancer fight. The dancer is notoriously weak to bleed, and the high DPS of the bandit's knife makes it a favorite for so level 1 runs. Sometimes, all you really need is a simple bandit's knife to get the job done. Stamina management is much easier with daggers, and any weaknesses they have are made obsolete if they are used to inflict bleed. So it goes without saying that I was pleasantly surprised with a quick and easy dancer fight. Lothric Castle is now open for exploration, which will give us more freedom with whatever weapon class we roll next. Speaking of which, it's that time again. Alright, so the only whip I have is the notched whip. That'll have to do for now. At the moment, I don't have the dexterity for it. But with the milk ring and one more level, I'll be right at the 19 I need. I figured it would be best to get Anor Londo out of the way before doing anything else. There are some important things here, most notably the Easterner's Ashes. And oh yeah, I almost forgot, my wedding ceremony! I don't know if the bleed on the whip will be much help at all, so just for fun, I infused it with fire to hopefully make it more useful against Aldrich. I wasn't a huge fan of the whip in this fight, but I can't really blame it for its struggle. Aldrich is obnoxious, as usual, but the fight wasn't completely hopeless. The whip has enough range to easily hit his head, and the fire infusion surely added at least a modicum of damage. But you know me, I never learn. After a long struggle with the spammer, I finally got him in a good spot where I could safely finish him off. Don't you dare try to teleport away. Finally, Aldrich is done. I picked up the Sun Princess ring on the top floor, which ended up being very useful later on in the playthrough. My vigor is now at 30, so depending on what we roll next, we can start focusing on some other stats. Up next we have Thrusting Swords. Once again, Grey Rat is our guy when we need a weapon. He's got a nice S-Stock for sale that will work just fine for wherever we go next. As for me, I wanted to stock up on some Titanite chunks, so the Consumed King's Garden became my destination. It's a short and sweet area, but one with some useful goodies scattered about. I was able to get the S-Stock to plus 7 before challenging Osiris. For this fight, I was sure to pack lots of gold pine resin for an even bigger damage boost. Just from this little snippet of the fight, you can see how chaotic this was. Our poor senile king spent half the fight running into this door, and since I was trapped under him, I really didn't have a clue what I was even doing. Throughout all the camera-shaking chaos, I kept my cool and spammed R1. Just another normal day with Old Man Jenkins. Nothing to see here, let's move on. Before spinning for the next weapon, I level up my strength for good measure. Not that it really mattered when my next roll ended up being crossbows. Crossbows in general have low stat requirements, but no scaling whatsoever, which means I need to find one that already has high AR. Thankfully, there's a good one hanging out back at the cathedral, but it'll take some upgrading to make it stand a chance against even the weakest of enemies. I'm not looking forward to all the bolts I'm gonna have to buy, but hopefully we won't run out too quickly. My original masochistic plan was to try Yorm, but I saw that, by some miracle, Siegvord was still in Irithyll. So my plans changed because I realized I hadn't failed Grey Rat's quest yet. Like I said, the Arbalest is in dire need of an upgrade. It took me 5 minutes just to kill this guy outside the Osiris Arena. I don't have a lot of souls to spend on upgrade materials since I also have to buy my ammo, so I found other ways to get large Titanite shards, and sold all those weapons I didn't need anymore to buy some more. I have a few choices as far as bosses go, but for now, I think our best bet is Champion Gundyr. This fight was weird. In the entirety of my first attempt, he didn't dodge a single bolt. But for every consecutive attempt, he dodged every single shot if he wasn't mid-attack. As for damage, the damage was decent. I at least did enough damage to ensure that one pack of bolts would be enough to finish the fight. But that charge attack was the bane of my existence. I think that attack single-handedly caused every death in this fight, and if not the attack itself, the combo he did after it. And there was also the time he did this crazy wall combo. Despite the trouble he gave me, I was determined to keep at it, and sure enough, with practice, I figured out how to approach his charge attack. The key to fighting with projectiles is to keep him either as far away as possible or at mid-range. The closer I was to him, the more trouble I had reacting to the charge. After the battle, I came home to see that Grey Rat had safely returned with some new upgrade materials, and we can use all the levels we earned to get some more endurance. The next weapon class is halberds, and what better halberd to use than the one we just got from defeating Gundyr? Now I'm the one in charge, and Alva doesn't even get a chance to get a word in edgewise. The halberd does a pretty good job at taking out those pesky jailers. Even those pesky invisible jailers. I managed to clear out this area pretty quickly, and save Carla in one sitting, in case we need her in the future. Seeing as I'm already here, I might as well go to Archdragon Peak and claim the bonfire to save myself the hassle later. I continue to invest into strength, and get the halberd to +3 before finishing up with the Profaned Capital. Yorm isn't nearly as intimidating to me as he was last time. Now that I have some decent experience without the Storm Ruler, I'm more confident with this fight. I believe I only died once this time around, so thankfully, Yorm wasn't a problem for this playthrough. Gundyr's halberd has good reach to hit his arms and head for a stagger, and a successful riposte will take out a huge chunk of his health each time. The only thing to watch out for are his extended combos in Phase 2. But once you learn all his extensions, you can think of it as Phase 1 with some fire. I used the souls from that fight to get strength to 30, but that's not going to make an immediate impact on anything just yet, because our next weapon class is katanas. I haven't managed to pick one up during this playthrough, so the easiest way to get one is from the naked guy outside Firelink, who I've pretended doesn't exist until now. He'll fall off the ledge on his own, you just have to be in the right spot. Wait, well, you'll at least come with me, right? There we go, a free Uchi Katana. Ancient Wyvern is Ancient Wyvern, and we have some free souls to get a little more stamina. Now comes the interesting part. For the next boss, we're actually gonna have to spin the wheel twice. The order of the weapon classes determines which one will be used for Phase 1 and Phase 2. The first weapon class, or the one I'll use on the King of the Storm, is Great Axes, and the second weapon class, for the Nameless King, will be Sacred Chimes. This is a weird combination, because to do this, we'll need decent investment into both strength and faith. Thankfully, there is a Great Axe that scales with both of those things. If you fall down near this little cave in Ariandel, you can grab the Earthseeker and get the heck out of there. You only need 16 strength to two-hand the axe, and the rest of your stats can be dumped into faith. Next, we'll need to start preparing everything we need to cast miracles. There are two rings to increase our miracle power, and a few divine tomes we can give to Carla. Of course, we'll also need the chime itself, so I chose Cathedral's chime for its affinity to dark miracles. One last thing before I move on. As someone pointed out to me last time, you can wait until Yorm is dead to free Siegfried, as he will not free himself or disappear, so you can still face Yorm on your own without killing him for a Titanite slab. Yeah, a duty. About that. I'll use that very tight night slab to max out my chime before taking on the Nameless King. Or maybe I won't challenge the Nameless King. Maybe I'll just die to his pet like a loser. Once I made it to phase 2, I was being really stubborn, trying to cast deep protection at all costs. But in the long run, it doesn't make much of a difference. What did make a difference was upgrading the Earthseeker to make phase 1 go by faster. I needed to focus all my energy on the Nameless King portion of the fight, and I needed to get used to having less Estus flasks. Here we are, Nameless King with only miracles. What do you need to do? Flies. That is all. Forget all your other miracles. The flies will be a million times better than all of them. Even if they miss, don't worry about it. These don't use too much FP and can be cast in quick succession. It only takes 2 hits to bleed him out, so if you are good at dodging, this should be laughably easy. I played around with Life Hunt Scythe a little bit. That one is much more risky than the flies and takes a while to cast. The flies can also be cast at any range, making them much more spam friendly. This is why Deep Protection ultimately ended up not being necessary, because even without it, 2 casts of the flies is just 1,000 of his HP gone. For the style points, I finished him off with Life Hunt Scythe. That's another thing taken care of. Now, shall we spin? Great hammers? That doesn't sound too bad. I've actually been wanting to use the Old King's Great Hammer for a while in this run. We're so far into the game that we can fully upgrade it, so considering that, it's probably a good time to try some of the DLC. I clear the Painted World in no time at all, and soon enough, I'm faced with Frida herself. Jeez, that is some big damage! I think this is going to be a bit easier than expected. On top of the damage that the Old King's Great Hammer brings on its own, I also have the Hornet Ring for some extra critical damage, making all the backstabs we can get even more rewarding. Yeah, I kind of forgot that big weapons just destroy Sister Frida. Sure, I still have to be careful when the big guy is slamming overhead, but for the most part, Frida herself will be easy to stun. So far, this was shaping up to be a great first attempt. I made it to phase 3 and had 9 flasks to spare. I only had to keep my cool and be careful with my punishes. There are still plenty of backstab opportunities, but also a few more attacks to watch out for, like this grab that I got hit by. Somehow, this ended up being done on the first try. I'm just shocked my hammer didn't break after carrying that whole fight. Sorry about your sister. I didn't get as many levels as you'd think for that fight, but enough for at least 2 more levels into Vitality. I know that whenever I land on Reapers, this is the scythe I'm gonna use, so I might as well make it right now. It's just too cool for its own good. But for now, we'll just have to see what weapon class the wheel decides for us next. The next weapon class we'll be using is Fists. Keeping up with the pattern of demon weapons, I made the Demon's Fist and decided to use it to wrap up the first DLC. The Gravetender and Great Wolf duo, or as most of us call it, 4 wolves and a guy, isn't a difficult fight regardless of the weapon class that is used. At first, I didn't even upgrade my fist that much, since damage didn't seem to be a big deal. But if there's anything I know about myself, it's that I'm inconsistent. While I can do a run and beat a boss like Sister Frida on the first try, you can guarantee that on that same run, I'll turn right back around and die to the Gravetender Great Wolf. Since that happened, I decided to commit to upgrading my fists to at least +3, then went hyper-aggressive on the NPC to avoid a duo fight. I got pretty lucky there and killed him moments before the Great Wolf joined the fight. And now that I only had one enemy to worry about, the rest was simple. That's enough DLC for now. We need to finish up with the base game before going to the Ringed City. As you can see, the next weapon class is Curved Greatswords. Not a bad roll at all. I haven't been keeping up with my levels as much since I do so much respecking in this playthrough, but I have gotten rid of a lot of dex levels and put them into other things, which is a problem now since we need it for the Exile Greatsword. Just for fun, let's see what it will be like without having the stats. I mean, we're getting it all the way to +9. It can't be that bad, right? It's bad. You can't get away with not having enough dex unless you can deal with your weapon bouncing off after every attack. I sure hope I don't die here, or I'll be forced to run back to Rosaria. Now that my stats are sorted out, this guy shouldn't be much of a problem at all. Maybe I can even give the Red Tearstone Ring a try. The second phase of this fight is nothing more than a game of tag around the fountain. Stupid butterflies. What are you gonna do now? At this point, I'm pretty much just leveling randomly, because let's face it, I've been needing to reallocate them every other fight anyway. Before we mess with our stats again, let's at least see what weapon class we're working with next. Reapers? Now we're talking. Looks like we're busting out the Frida Scythe sooner than expected. This is one of my favorite weapons in the game. It has a fun, unique moveset, and with its weapon art being a stance, it offers even more versatility. Plus, it has hyper armor when using the special skills, which is always useful. Look at this. I love the way your character slides while using this. It reminds me a bit of an ice skater. When the castle is cleared out, we have plenty of Titanite scales to go towards upgrading the scythe. We can also get a few cheaper ones from Grey Rat's Ashes. Here's how my stats are looking after lots of respecs. I've dumped a lot more into Vigor, and 40 will be where I stop it for the rest of the playthrough. There's no choice left but to proceed to the last Lord of Cinder as we close out the base game. I had a lot of fun fighting them with Frida's scythe. They both have fairly high frost resistance, but the physical damage alone was enough to make up for it. For this playthrough, I had a really good first attempt. Lothric was two swings away from death. But sometimes, in the heat of the moment, you'll mistime a roll, which triggered a domino effect in my case. I didn't let that get my spirits down. By the third attempt, I was in a similar situation, where Lothric was a couple hits away from death, and I was out of Estus. Miraculously, I played this extremely patiently, which is no doubt how I managed to survive the fight with so little health remaining. There's nothing to do now but once again spin the wheel of fate. And, as fate would have it, we are once again faced with our destiny to use a greatbow. We're gonna go on a quick outing to Ariandel for the Millwood Greatbow, then come back home to max it out. It's gonna be annoying, but we have no choice but to buy as much ammo as we can and hope we don't become short on souls if we use them up. Now that the lords are all upon their thrones, the time has come for the Firekeeper to lead us to the kiln with a bold statement in fashion? The time has come to embrace our destiny and challenge the final boss with nothing but the arrows we can hold. At first, I was worried about the inventory limit, but after testing out the damage with an opening shot, it seemed my worries were unfounded. Well, at least my worries about having enough arrows were unfounded. Forget about doing enough damage, every other aspect of this fight was a nightmare. Soul of Cinder was by far the most difficult fight of the whole run. It's not even a competition. As is the case with all great bows, every shot consumes a lot of stamina, and for characters with low to moderate endurance, that will end up being the whole stamina bar. Sometimes I got lucky and had time to input a roll, but most of the time, I was just leaving myself wide open for retaliation after each shot. Let's talk about phase one for a moment. The first part, or the straight sword, I can deal with. There may not be many openings, but at the very least, I can wait it out until he chooses something different. The curved sword, I also can deal with. He has a few openings during this phase when he casts pyromancy, but to make up for his openings, he can also roll in this phase, so my attack timing has to be just right. The spear. Oh god, the spear. This part is what made the entire fight a living hell. Not only does this phase have no guaranteed openings, but he also will heal if you loiter too long without attacking. Since it was virtually impossible to pull off a safe shot during the spear part, my only real opening was the healing itself, but it is very rarely interrupted, so the damage you get might as well be a waste of an arrow after he heals it all back. Sometimes I got lucky and got a headshot or a stagger, but that was just dumb luck from the uneven terrain. Lastly, we have the mage. After something like the spear moveset, it's a breath of fresh air to have so many openings. Sure, this phase is spammy, but in most cases, you can just tank through the magic and fire off as many arrows as your heart desires. The final laser looks intimidating, but he can be easily staggered out of it, and even if it hits you, a simple roll to the side will prevent it from killing you. So, that's phase 1 in a nutshell, but what about phase 2? Phase 2 was much easier than phase 1, I can tell you that right away. My main problem here was my own nerves. After getting through the marathon of phase 1 and using all my Estus, it was only natural that I started to panic a little. The good thing about phase 2 is that all of his attacks are easier to dodge, and he has a huge combo to guarantee one or even two shots of the great bow. But as my health got low, I succumbed to my panic rolling instinct and had to start over again. So here we are, many farming sessions for arrows later, and I'm down to my last 10 great arrows. I saved my Millwood great arrows for phase 2 because of their high damage. I was much more confident that the arrows wouldn't go to waste during this phase. I also adjusted my setup by bringing the Ring of Favor for some extra stamina, and using the Sun Princess Ring to save Estus as I waited for openings. There's a small chance that my arrows will fly over his head as he ducks for the AoE, and I did not want to run out of arrows after all my hard work. In order to secure my victory, I started using the weapon art, and was not disappointed by the damage boost. With only 4 great arrows to spare, I saw my opportunity as he leapt towards me in a final act of desperation, and I took the shot. Still basking in my victory, I took the spoils from his soul and got a few levels into endurance to make sure another situation like this one never happens again. We can really see the wheel thinning out at this point, and we're going to take another big chunk out of it because the next boss will need 2 weapon classes. Interestingly, I once again am using both Miracles and Melee for a 2-part boss. Everything really does just come full circle. For phase 1 of the Demon Twins, I have a simple canvas talisman to cast my flies with. Did you actually think I was going to use that sunlight spear I just made when I have flies? Okay, to be fair, I tested it out a few times, but I couldn't justify that FP cost when the flies were right there doing twice the damage. I even tried Life Hunt Scythe again, but that just wasn't working out. My reward for being so indecisive with my miracles was running out of FP, and being forced to use my talisman as a melee weapon to finish it off. So, flies it is for phase 1, and for phase 2, I chose the Irithyll Straight Sword. The damage turned out to be pathetic with his increased absorption, and he's immune to frost, which is probably the only thing this weapon would have going for it otherwise. I decided to switch to the Sunlight Straight Sword. This was a much better choice since it scaled with faith. It's a simple sword, but it gets the job done and consistently staggers the Demon Prince during the laser, which is where you'll do the most damage during this fight. I could have tried to challenge myself with the other Demon Prince moveset. Or not, nobody feels like doing that. Maybe another day. So let's go ahead and get some levels before moving on to our next weapon. The wheel has chosen for us claws. I had some crow talons collecting dust in my inventory, so I decided to finally get some use out of them. This time, we're gonna do Madeir first. Totally not because I saw that bows are still on the wheel or anything like that. Before dropping into the fight, let's get the talons to plus 10. Our claws are as ready as they'll ever be, but Madeir put up quite a fight on the first attempt. As you can see by my one Estus flask, I still need some time to get my bearings. Somehow, my second attempt went very smoothly. I found out in my last DS3 video that for whatever reason, the Madeir fight has just clicked with me. This fight used to intimidate me, but I think it's held up well over the years, and I have come to enjoy this more than any other FromSoft dragon fight. With only two bosses left in the game, the final fight still looms ahead with the probability that bows will be the last roll. This may be a disappointment for the most evil among you guys, but it turns out I'll only have to use a bow for half light. Mind you, this fight was anything but light work. Deep down, I knew an NPC fight with a bow would be Dodge City, but I didn't think it would cause as many problems as it did. This took more tries than Gale and Madeir combined. For one, there was my impatience. But another thing that caused problems was those stupid painting guardians. Is it really fair that both them and the boss NPC have frame-perfect dodges, combined with their ability to fully heal each other? This proved to be a real test of my patience. Anytime I thought I was making progress, the second guardian would waltz in and undo all the progress I'd made. The only way to beat this fight was, God forbid, to have patience. I found a few opportunities where they couldn't dodge an arrow, so I just had to accept that they would heal or try to interrupt it. This still wasn't easy for me. Many times, I had to tank through projectiles to get my shot, but in the end, I figured out Half-Light's patterns and found a perfect opportunity to sidestep his weapon art for a guaranteed counter. There's not much of a point to leveling anymore, but why not do it anyway? I don't need to roll again, because we all know the final weapon class is curved swords. I wanted to have an epic fight with Gale, so I chose the Demon Scar. Its uniqueness alone makes it my favorite weapon in Dark Souls 3, and while it isn't the best curved sword out there, it is absolutely the coolest. Aside from how awesome it looks, it does pure fire damage that scales from both intelligence and faith. Not only that, but as an added feature, it can cast pyromancy. So if you're a pyromancer, you can use it as a melee weapon when you run out of FP. Admittedly, the damage was a bit lacking during the Gale fight, but I didn't let that discourage me. After the previous battle with Half-Light, I was conditioned to be patient in situations like these. So while I didn't manage to first try Gale, I did manage to get him on the second try. The music will get your heart beating during this fight, I can tell you that. When that phase 3 transition starts, you will feel that sense of urgency nagging at you. But don't be fooled, this fight is a classic test of patience. If you watch his patterns closely and punish accordingly, you will be rewarded. That's not to say that I was completely patient though. I had to rely on an ember when my Estus was all used up, and once again, the Sun Princess Ring came in clutch at the end of the playthrough. That extra bit of health gave me the boost I needed to finish this run in style. Thank you so much for watching this video. I really appreciate your interest in my playthroughs. If you have any suggestions for future videos, or some tips you'd like to share, feel free to do so in the comments. I had a lot of fun doing this challenge, and I can't wait for the next one.